गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल. आई डॉक्टर अनुरिका मेहता, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ अप्लाइड साइंस, पूर्णिमा इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग एंड टेक्नोलॉजी, जयपुर, वेलकम्स यू ऑल इन 5-डे शॉर्ट टर्म ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम ऑन एनवायरमेंटल इम्पैक्ट ऑफ COVID-19 पैनडेमिक चैलेंजेस एंड रेमेडीज थ्रू साइंस एंड इंजीनियरिंग. वेलकम यू ऑल. इट इज़ अवर प्राउड प्रिविलेज टू वेलकम यू ऑल हेयर at this auspicious occasion. It is indeed a great honor that we have galaxy of renowned personality gracing the occasion. We feel a sense of pride and welcoming our honorable respected chief guest of the occasion, Professor R.A. Gupta sir, vice chancellor, Rajasthan Technical University, Kota. Welcome you sir. Welcoming our patron of the short-term training program, Dr. Dinesh Goyal sir, Principal, Purnima Institute of Engineering and Technology, Jaipur. Welcome you sir. Welcoming our program chair, Dr. Gautam Singh, Registrar, PIET, and Dr. Sama Jain, HOD, Department of Applied Science, PIET. Welcome you sir and ma'am. A warm welcome to all our guests, eminent speakers, and participants from different states of country. I would like to request HOD, Department of Applied Science, Purnima Institute of Engineering and Technology, Dr. Sama Jain, to introduce the short-term training program. Please, ma'am.
Good morning to one and all present here. Honorable Professor R.A. Gupta, Vice Chancellor, Rajasthan Technical University, Kota. Dr. Neelima Gupta, awardee, first woman secretary in chemical society and vice principal Maharaja College, University of Rajasthan, Jaipur. Respected Dr. Dinesh Goyal, director, Purnima Institute of Engineering and Technology. Dr. Gautam Singh, registrar, PIET, and all the participants, faculty members, students, good morning to one and all. The environment is an integral component of human and animal health, and COVID-19 is a global health challenge in the 21st century. This COVID-19 pandemic has huge impact on most aspects of human activities, as well as on the economy and healthcare system. Lockdown, quarantine, and border closure in the wake of pandemic have led to reduction in air pollution through decreased travel and production. These positive environmental effects are, of course, temporary, but serve as an example to change the way of our life. The aim of this short-term training program is to sensitize the faculty members, research scholars, and students about environmental problems, biodiversity, sustainability, climate change, and to realize public health issues in COVID-19 crisis through these online sessions. This week-long training program would be helpful to get an idea of environmental impact of this crisis and its challenges, ongoing research activities, and possible research solution to fight against this problem. In the recent past, several faculty development programs, e-seminars, and workshops have been organized to understand the complex environmental issues and spread awareness among people. But this program is unique in the sense that it also encompasses the present COVID-19 crisis. So we will be having 10 experts from various fields to interact with us during the coming 5 days. All these experts will deliver special talk on specific topic of their expertise. So please have a look on our program through a small video presentation. This video will definitely show a summary of our ongoing 10 different sessions from different experts from different field of our from different parts of the country. Thank you.
Of this short-term training program. Now it's time to hear or invite our director sir, Dr. Dinesh Goyal, principal, Purnima Institute of Engineering and Technology, for welcome address with us. Please, sir.
Thank you so much, Anurika ma'am. Honorable Arya Gupta sir, Vice Chancellor, Raisen Technical University. First of all, I extend my warm thanks to you, sir, for accepting our kind request on phone. I know you're quite busy and your engagements are quite high. In this time also, you have spared a valuable time for us. Thank you so much for this accepting our request, sir. Dr. Neelima Gupta, ma'am, thank you so much for joining us. She Vice Principal, Maharani College. And all the participants, I welcome all of you on behalf of Purnima Institute of Engineering and Technology. During this session, I'd like to cover two parts. First of all, I'd like to talk to you about the journey of Purnima Institute of Engineering and Technology. PIET has been established in the year 2007 and is one of the affiliated college of Raisen Technical University under the esteemed guidance of Dr. Arya Gupta sir and his strong team. And in past 2 years, we have achieved many milestones with the kind support of Raisen Technical University and management of Purnima Group. The first one is that we are now NBA accredited in three programs, electrical engineering, computer engineering, and civil engineering. Just to share, Dr. Arya Gupta is quite proud of us also for this, that we are the only college in Rajasthan who's having NBA accreditation in civil engineering department. No other college has been able to achieve NBA accreditation in civil engineering department. And this is all effort of teachers and students who have made quality, who has taken quality education as a priority under the esteemed guidance of Raisen Technical University. Our institution is accredited by NAC. We have achieved NAC accreditation in year 1920 only. And we are attempting to improve further in this accreditation and quality parameters. Apart from this, with the support of TechCube and AICTE and DST and many other agencies, we have been able to achieve funding of more than 30 lakh rupees in past 1 year for various activities and research grants. Our faculty members are working on around 8 research projects with different agencies. We have been able to achieve 3 SCA publications and 14 Scopus publications in last 1 year. This all quantifies what we are doing in terms of quality education, and the exercise which we are doing today, FDP, are again on the same roads of empowering our team and sharing maximum knowledge to our peers so that tomorrow higher education at the large can be benefited and PIT can grow as a bloom as an organization, as a nodal center to create knowledge, disseminate knowledge, not only disseminate knowledge, to also create knowledge. Coming to this FDP, we are thanking, first of all, ISTE for sponsoring this FDP to us. We are thankful to ISTE and Raisen Technical University both for sponsoring this activity to us. We have seen this pandemic and I don't know when it will end, but we seriously know that the time is not good right now for all of us and we have to be extra careful. But we have seen a lot of environmental benefits because of this pandemic also. We have realized that cost of life is lesser than what we were spending in the life. We are creating a lot of pollution. We are creating a lot of industrial waste. This gives a roadmap to us that we can survive even without doing a lot of harm to the environment. We have been surviving for the last 4-5 months in India and globally for the last around 8-9 months. So if we can practice in real life after this pandemic also, we all of us can create a new society which will be corona free after 6 months also, and which will be environment friendly also after 6 months or so. I hope this next 10 deliberations of experts in next 5 days will groom all the faculty members of Pan India. I was going through the video. We are having experts from BITS Pilani, BARC also, and many other premier institutes and organizations across the country. So we welcome all the experts for this session. And of course, we need to thank all the participants who are joining us to go this undertake this FDP. Also, we are having more than 300 participations, as Zoom is having limited this thing of 100 participants only. 100 are available on this platform, and rest all are on Facebook live session of this one. With these words, I welcome all of you again. I hope this next 5 days will be a good learning for all academicians and students. And I welcome Honorable President, Vice Chancellor again. Thank you, Anurika ma'am, please.
Thank you so much, sir, for your words. Now it's time to hear eminent personality, Professor R.A. Gupta sir, Vice Chancellor, Rajasthan Technical University, Kota, for words of wisdom. Dr. R.A. Gupta, with his teaching and research experience of 36 years, is currently working as Vice Chancellor, Rajasthan Technical University, Kota, Rajasthan. He has completed his PhD from IIT Roorkee in 1996. More than 200 research publications and 5 books are to his credit. He has received 2 Best Paper Awards for the paper presented at the international conferences. He has been bestowed with 1 Doctoral Category Research Award, Power System Award also. He has presented his paper at various national and international conferences organized from time to time. Dr. Gupta has performed many administrative duties too, like officiating Director MNIT, Chairman, Departmental Research Committee, Dean Faculty Welfare, Convener Accreditation Committee, Coordinator TCUBE, and so on. He has his flag high in the professional field also. He has been the Independent Director at the Board of Jaipur, Ajmer, and Jodhpur Vidyut Vitran Nigam Limited, respectively. He has been the member AQIS Proposal Evaluation Committee, AICTE, New Delhi. His professional profile includes the performance of various activities as data auditor, resource person, technical program chair, and convener. Further, his career profile consists of his association as an expert member with AICTE since 1999, and highlights his nomination as an expert of various committees formed for different educational purposes. He is associated with UGC also as an expert member for the conferment or review since 2005. He has been a team leader of assessment team in 2009. He has played a significant role as an expert member, Government of Rajasthan Education Department, and evaluated various DST projects also in 2017 and 18. His career includes working as an expert of some of the selection committees, which includes DRDO, UPSC, RPSC, DST, Rajasthan. Further, he has worked as a member board of Studies Academic Planning Committee, which took place at renowned educational universities and institutions. As a guide, he has supervised 16 PhD and more than 10 MTech are under his supervision at present, and many more to come. He has been involved in sponsored research activities from MHRD and AICTE. Many research labs for PhD students have also been established under his guidance. He has not only organized various conferences and conventions, but also chaired and attended the same for time to time. Please, sir.
Thank you very much, Anurika. I really very happy to hear Sometimes I myself also forget about my contribution. it's basically continuous association with the technical education. From 1999, all the colleges in Rajasthan, I'm sure that I am involved in their basically association with AICT, and I visited almost all the colleges for their approval, and started this technical education in Rajasthan, and Purnima is one of them. So from 1999, from the day one when this Purnima basically started, and the first visit came in Rajasthan, from that day I am connected with this college and other colleges also, and I have seen very closely this technical education in Rajasthan. So now at different platform I am again connected with this college and as a vice chancellor Rajasthan Technical University. So I am here with a dream, actually, with the Rajasthan Technical University, that I want to improve technical education in Rajasthan, and I want to bring it at a very high level of technical education. So I'm trying hard basically to do so many activities in different colleges through this TechUpe third, and we are giving funding. Those who are coming to us without taking no time, we are giving funding them. We don't want to ask much questions to my colleges, actually, no? I think when I am open and I am coming freely to them, so they can understand that technical education with them. सबसे पहले मैंने सारे चेयरमैन को यहाँ बुलाया था आरटीयू में, एंड उसको उसमें हमने ये कन्वे करने की कोशिश की कि सारे जो चेयरमैन हैं उनके साथ हम बिल्कुल जुड़े हुए हैं और उनकी बातें भी हम सुन रहे हैं और सुनना चाहते हैं, और अपनी बात भी उनको बताना चाहते हैं कि हम टेक्निकल एजुकेशन को बहुत ऊपर राजस्थान में ले जाना चाहते हैं. फिर हमने प्रिंसिपल्स को भी इनवाइट किया था, डायरेक्टर्स को इनवाइट किया था. मुझे मालूम है कि दिनेश गोयल आल्सो विजिटेड, एंड वी प्रोवाइड देम वेरी गुड फूड आल्सो देयर.
यस सर, यस सर.
उसके बाद काफी चीजें अच्छी हुई हैं और हमने काफी चीजें यहाँ इम्प्रूवमेंट किया, सिलेबस इम्प्रूवमेंट किया. AICT का सिलेबस हमने लगा दिया, और जो हमारा एक 20-80% का जो था सेशनल्स, 20% और 80% का जो हमारा थ्योरी पेपर था, उसको हमने 30-70 कर दिया, कि जिससे स्टूडेंट जो है वो कॉलेज में ज़्यादा रहे, उसकी ज़्यादा अटेंडेंस वहाँ हो, ज़्यादा लर्निंग हो, और एक अच्छा रिलेशन बने, ह्यूमन वैल्यूज उसमें आए. ये सारी चीज़ें हम लोग बिल्कुल लगातार करते जा रहे हैं, और मैं समझता हूँ कि ये चीज़ें काफ़ी आगे तक लेके जाएंगी. आज का टॉपिक बड़ा अच्छा है, और यू हैव वेरी गुड स्पीकर्स. मैं स्पीकर्स को भी इसके लिए, जैसे नीलिमा जी का नाम आपने बताया, मैंने पहले भी इनके बारे में सुना हुआ है. सी इज वेरी गुड स्पीकर एंड अदर स्पीकर्स ऑल्सो देयर. तो ये सब एक्सपर्ट लोग हैं, इनको हम सुनेंगे. मैं सिर्फ इतना ही बताना चाह रहा हूँ कि ये जो एनवायरमेंटल इश्यूज है, इसको हमने ऐसे बिल्कुल देखा है. इस COVID-19 का जो सबसे बड़ा एडवांटेज मैं देख रहा हूँ कि हम 1:1 में देख रहे हैं कि अगर हम इस तरफ ध्यान देते हैं, अभी तो फोर्सफुली दे रहे हैं, फोर्सफुली व्हीकल्स आर नॉट देयर ऑन रोड, और इसकी वजह से कितना एनवायरमेंट साफ हो गया, कितनी जो है लोगों को प्योर ऑक्सीजन मिल रही है. तो ये एक इम्पैक्ट है, इसका नेगेटिविटी जरूर है, लेकिन एनवायरनमेंट को साफ रखने से क्या फायदे होते हैं, ये हमको बिल्कुल दिख रहा है इसमें. और ये बता दूं कि एनवायरनमेंट में सबसे बड़ा जो कंट्रीब्यूशन होता है वो होता है हमारे जो हम पेड़ पौधे लगाते हैं और नेचर को संभाल के रखते हैं। अभी जैसे ट्री प्लांटेशन का काफी अच्छा काम चल रहा है। AICT ने RTU को एक अवार्ड भी दिया था ट्री प्लांटेशन में लास्ट ईयर, वन स्टूडेंट वन ट्री। तो ये आप लोगों को भी ये करना चाहिए और आपको एक एरिया भी चूज करना चाहिए कि जयपुर के आसपास में आप लेके जाएं अपने स्टूडेंट्स को, क्योंकि पूर्णिमा का तो आपने ग्रीन कर लिया पूरा, आप उसमें और ज्यादा पेड़ लगाएंगे तो क्राउड हो जाएगा। तो ऐसी जगह चुन करके और आप वहां जाएं। और ये बता दूं आपको कि अभी रिसेंटली मैंने एक ऐसा ही प्रोग्राम वहां पे किया था उदयपुर में। उन्होंने किया था ग्रेटिट्यूड एंड कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन। तो ग्रेटिट्यूड एक बड़ा गजब का जो है उन्होंने वर्ड पकड़ा और मैंने उसको बहुत अच्छे से समझने की कोशिश की। ग्रेटिट्यूड का ये मतलब होता है कि कृतज्ञता आपकी होनी चाहिए। और ये कृतज्ञता जो शब्द है ये बहुत जबरदस्त शब्द है। आप इसको यूं देखें कि नीलिमा जी इसको अप्रिशिएट करेंगी कि पहले के जमाने में हम सुबह उठ के सूर्य को पानी देते थे और पीपल के पेड़ की पूजा करते थे। ये हमारी उनके प्रति कृतज्ञता होती थी, क्योंकि सूर्य की अगर रेज नहीं मिले, रोशनी नहीं मिले तो हमारा हमारा सर्वाइवल नहीं है। अगर पीपल के पेड़ को हम पानी क्यों देते हैं कि वो एक ऑक्सीजन हमको बहुत एम्पल ऑक्सीजन वहां से मिलती है और उससे हमारी जिंदगी है। अब पॉइंट ये आता है कि जैसे आप जब इसको महसूस करते हैं ग्रेटिट्यूड, मतलब उसके प्रति कृतज्ञ होते हैं कि यार ये पीपल का पेड़ है, इसकी वजह से मैं सर्वाइवल में हूँ, तो फिर आप उसको जो है उसके लिए उसको खाद पानी वो सारी चीजें आप देना शुरू करते हैं। तो जब आप किसी के प्रति कृतज्ञ होते हैं तब आप उसकी देखरेख शुरू करते हैं। तो अब जब आप इस कॉलेज में, जैसे पूर्णिमा कॉलेज में आपकी फैकल्टी आती है, स्टूडेंट आते हैं, अगर वो ये कृतज्ञता महसूस करें कि इस कॉलेज में आने की वजह से हमारा सर्वाइवल है, तो आप इस कॉलेज की देखरेख करेंगे। इस कॉलेज में स्टूडेंट पढ़ते हैं उनकी वजह से हमारा सर्वाइवल है, तो फिर स्टूडेंट के प्रति आपकी कृतज्ञता जो बढ़ेगी और फिर आपकी रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी वहां से शुरू होगी कि हम इनको अच्छा कंटेंट दें, इनको अच्छा पढ़ाएं, इनमें ह्यूमन वैल्यूज करें, इनको नेचर के प्रति जागरूक करें। ये आप तब करेंगे इस स्टूडेंट के प्रति जब इनके प्रति आप कृतज्ञ होंगे। और जब आप इनके प्रति कृतज्ञ होंगे तो स्टूडेंट जो है अपनी इंस्टीट्यूट के प्रति कृतज्ञ होंगे। आप क्लासरूम में स्टूडेंट बैठा हुआ है और वो फर्नीचर को, जिस फर्नीचर पर बैठा है उसके क्वालिटी को अगर वो मेंटेन करता है तो एक अच्छे फर्नीचर पर उसको बैठने का मौका मिलता है, ये उसके प्रति कृतज्ञता होगी। तो आप उसको साल संभाल करेंगे। आपके जैसे स्विच बोर्ड है उसको बच्चे तोड़ देते हैं, फिर तोड़ने के बाद में वो 10 दिन तक ठीक नहीं होता, उसे डबल लॉस होता है। एक तो आपने उसको नुकसान किया, अब आपको नया स्विच लगाना पड़ेगा, नया स्विच बनाने के लिए और नया स्विच बनाने के लिए इंडस्ट्री में ज्यादा सामान बनाने के लिए ज्यादा एनवायरमेंट को खराब करेंगे, तो एनवायरमेंट वहां से भी खराब होता है। तो अगर जो आपके पास है अगर उसकी रेस्पेक्ट करते हैं, उसको संभाल के रखते हैं, तो वो सामान ज्यादा दिनों तक चलता है, अच्छी एफिशिएंसी से चलता है। अब व्हीकल को देख लीजिए, आप कार चलाते हैं, अगर उसकी लगातार मेंटेनेंस करते हैं, मेंटेनेंस करने का मतलब क्या है, उसके प्रति कृतज्ञ होना, तो उसकी एवरेज बेटर होती है। एवरेज की बेटर होती है तो कार्बन कम छोड़ता है, कार्बन कम छोड़ता है तो एनवायरमेंट खराब नहीं होता। व्हीकल ज्यादा दिन चलता है, अब व्हीकल अगर मार्केट में ज्यादा दिन चलेगा तो कम व्हीकल बनाने पड़ेंगे, कम व्हीकल बनाने पड़ेंगे तो उससे फिर आपका एनवायरमेंट खराब नहीं होगा। तो एनवायरमेंट को अगर जोड़ने के लिए आपको हर व्यक्ति को ये बताना पड़ेगा कि जो आपके पास है उसकी रेस्पेक्ट करें, और जब उसकी रेस्पेक्ट करते हैं तो उसकी लाइफ को बढ़ाते हैं, उसके प्रति आप रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी फील करते हैं, और जब उसकी लाइफ बढ़ाते हैं तो आप देखिए मिस्टर दिनेश, आपको ये लगने लगेगा कि यार इतनी तनख्वाह क्यों मिल रही है, ये तो आधी तनख्वाह में काम होने लग जाएगा आपका, क्योंकि खर्चा ही बंद हो गया।
बिल्कुल सही बात है सर।
ये मेरा ये मानना है कि एनवायरनमेंट को अगर आपको संभालना है तो सबसे पहले आपको जो लोग हैं सोसाइटी में चाहे वो आपके पेरेंट्स हैं, चाहे आपके बच्चे हैं, हर एक को आपको सुनना पड़ेगा, पेशेंसली सुनना पड़ेगा। एक्चुअली में सुनने में भी दो बातें होती हैं, एक तो आप उसके वर्ड सुनते हैं और एक आप उसको टोटलिटी में सुनते हैं, उसके मन में क्या चल रहा है उसको सुनते हैं, और उसके मन में क्या चल रहा है सुनने के लिए आपको साइलेंट होना पड़ेगा। वरना आपने दो लोगों की वार्तालाप सुनना कभी, आप तो प्रिंसिपल हैं, आप तो बहुत नॉलेजेबल हैं, आप क्लास में या कहीं भी दो लोगों की वार्तालाप सुनना, आपको पता लगेगा कोई किसी की नहीं सुन रहा है, और हर व्यक्ति बोल रहा है। तो उस लेवल का पेशेंस भी लाना पड़ेगा। और स्टूडेंट जो है हमारा बहुत बड़ा रिसोर्स है, जो कल इस सोसाइटी को वही संभालने वाला है। आपके बच्चे आपको संभालने वाले हैं, आपके स्टूडेंट आपको हर जगह मिलने वाले हैं, चाहे आप कहीं भी जाएं, चाहे आप एयरपोर्ट पे जाएंगे वहां पर कोई इंजीनियर स्टूडेंट मिल जाएगा, आप कहीं पे रेलवे स्टेशन पे जाएंगे आपको कोई स्टूडेंट वहां मिल जाएगा। दे ऑल आर देयर, और वो आपको उसी तरीके का रेस्पॉन्स देंगे अगर आपने उनको अभी दिया है, अभी आप देखिए ट्रेन में, आप देखो ट्रेन में आप बैठे हैं, कहीं सीट टूटी हुई है, कहीं पे सीट की में से वो निकाल दिया, उसका सीट को फाड़ करके उसका कुछ निकाल देते हैं, उसका जो भी उसमें फोम वगैरह है, उस टाइम तो आप नहीं ध्यान देते इस चीज का। ये हमारा सबसे बड़ी कमी है हमारी सोसाइटी में, और फिर हमको नेक्स्ट डे उसी ट्रेन में उस टूटी हुई सीट पर बैठना पड़ता है। हम सोसाइटी के प्रति केयरलेस हैं, केयरफुल नहीं है, हम हमारे संसाधनों के प्रति केयरलेस हैं, केयरफुल नहीं है, और हमको ही फिर वापस उस पर बैठना पड़ता है, झेलना पड़ता है। आपके व्हीकल की एफिशिएंसी आप 40% कर दो, 60% पेट्रोल आपने ज्यादा यूज किया क्योंकि एफिशिएंसी 40% है, बाकी कार्बन में खत्म हो गया। कल जब आप मार्केट में पेट्रोल लेने जाएगा आपको ज्यादा महंगा मिलेगा, बिकॉज यू आर नॉट रिस्पॉन्सिबल। तो ये चीजें मैं समझता हूँ कि ये अभी एक्सपर्ट्स जब अपने टॉक डिलीवर करेंगे तो सारी बातें बताएंगे, पर मैं एक्सपर्ट्स को भी ये बताना चाहता हूँ कि ये एंगल हमको लेके चलना पड़ेगा, क्योंकि आप देखिए कि मैक्सिमम स्टूडेंट पूर्णिमा पढ़ते हैं, तो अगर ये स्टूडेंट इसी लेवल पे हमने इनको ठीक कर दिया, इनको जिम्मेदारी समझा दी, तो सोसाइटी को ठीक कर दिया आपने। ऐसे ही दूसरी कॉलेजेस हमारे राजस्थान में हमारी सारी कॉलेज बहुत अच्छी हैं, और हम ये सिखा रहे हैं उनको कि आपको ये स्टूडेंट्स जो अभी हम क्या कर रहे हैं कि हम कनेक्टेड ही नहीं है, स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी से कनेक्टेड नहीं है, फैकल्टी स्टूडेंट से कनेक्टेड नहीं है, हम अपनी अपनी बातें कह रहे हैं पर सुन कोई किसी की नहीं रहा है। ये कनेक्टिविटी बढ़ानी पड़ेगी, और ये कनेक्टिविटी इंडस्ट्री में, मैं कई बार नीलिमा जी मैं आपको बताता हूँ, इंडस्ट्री के लोगों को जब हम कई बार बात करते हैं तो वो कहते हैं कि सर आप हमको जो है ना ये जो जितना 100% इंजीनियर जो बना के दे रहे हो ना, आप 90% इंजीनियर दे दो पर मोटिवेटेड दे दो।
बिल्कुल,
ये जो नेगेटिविटी लेके जो आते हैं, 8 साल तक 7 साल तक हम फेल करते रहते हैं एक सब्जेक्ट में, और उस सब्जेक्ट को फेल करते जाएंगे और बच्चे में नेगेटिविटी आती चली जाएगी, फिर उसको इंडस्ट्री में भेजते हैं बहुत अच्छे नंबर दे करके, और वो बच्चा इतना डिप्रेस हुआ होता है कि वो मालिकों की भी नहीं सुनता और इंडस्ट्री में ठीक से काम ही नहीं करता। तो वो कह रहे हैं कि यार बाकी हम सिखा लेंगे, बाकी हम पढ़ा लेंगे, पर बच्चा मोटिवेटेड दे दो आप, क्योंकि इंडस्ट्री में जाने के बाद भी वहां लर्निंग होती है उसकी जो इंजीनियरिंग वहां पे है वो वहीं पे सीखता है, उस मशीन पे जाकर सीखता है। यहाँ पे हम एक एटीट्यूड देते हैं इंजीनियरिंग का, वहां पे प्रॉपर वर्क करता है। तो एटीट्यूड देते वक्त अगर पॉजिटिविटी भी साथ में देंगे तो दैट विल कंट्रीब्यूट ए लॉट, और हम यहाँ पे उसको उसकी सुनते नहीं, उसको डिप्रेशन में लाते हैं, उसको रगड़ते रहते हैं, और फिर वो इंडस्ट्री में जाता है और वो नेगेटिविटी में जाता है, वहां पर फिर कोई प्रोडक्शन नहीं आता। तो इंडस्ट्री वालों की शिकायत है कि आप हमें इंजीनियर तो दें लेकिन मोटिवेटेड दें। अब मोटिवेशन कहाँ से आएगा नीलिमा जी, आप बताओ? मोटिवेशन आएगा इंस्टीट्यूट में जब फैकल्टी और स्टूडेंट कनेक्टेड होंगे। तो ये यही मेरा कहना है राजस्थान टेक्निकल यूनिवर्सिटी के प्लेटफॉर्म से कि हम अवेलेबल हैं, एनी टाइम यू कैन कम टू अस, आई एम रेडी टू लिसन, लेकिन एक पॉजिटिव एनवायरमेंट राजस्थान में क्रिएट करें, सारे कॉलेजेस में क्रिएट करें, और हम आरटीयू में ये बिल्कुल ये हमने प्रॉमिस ले लिया है कि हमारे पास हमारे फैकल्टी के पास, हमारे डीन्स के पास कभी भी कोई आएगा, वी आर रेडी टू लिसन और पॉजिटिवली सुनेंगे और हर प्रॉब्लम को इमीडिएटली सॉल्व करेंगे, चाहे वो फैकल्टी की हो चाहे वो स्टूडेंट की हो। तो चलिए, थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर इन्वाइटिंग मी ऑन दिस प्लेटफॉर्म, और सभी जो है फैकल्टी को मैं धन्यवाद करता हूँ, स्टूडेंट्स जो कनेक्टेड हैं उनको मैं फिर से धन्यवाद करता हूँ कि उन्होंने मुझे सुना, और हम एक अच्छा माहौल बनाते हैं, टेक्निकली भी एनवायरनमेंट भी अच्छा क्रिएट करते हैं, कनेक्टिविटी भी लेके आते हैं, और एक अच्छा म्यूजिक, अच्छा संगीत एनवायरनमेंट में हम क्रिएट करें, ये मैं सोचता हूँ कि ऐसा होना चाहिए। थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर इनवाइटिंग मी, थैंक यू
सो मच सर।
Thank you, sir, for your inspirational and motivational words, and we will definitely work on it. Now, I would like to invite Mohit Bajpayee, sir, Deputy Attorney, Department of Applied Science, Purnima Institute of Engineering and Technology, for vote of thanks. Please, sir.
Welcome, ma'am. I am Mohit Bajpayee, Assistant Professor, Purnima Institute of Engineering and Technology. It is my privilege to share a short epilogue on this auspicious occasion. I would like to thank Professor Dr. Arya Gupta sir, Vice Chancellor, Rajasthan Technical University, Kota, for finding his busy schedule a time for this event. Thank you so much, sir, for sharing such a wonderful session, a wonderful comments with all of us and all the participants. I would like also to thank Dr. Dinesh Goyal sir, our principal PIET, for continuous guidance throughout the session and organize such event. I would like also thank to our organizing team, our department team, for the backbone is the backbone of this STPP. None other than, I would like to thank the loving participants, dear participants from the different states of the country who joined this session as a wonderful, to make this a wonderful event. Thank you everyone. Thank you so much, sir, for sharing his valuable comments and the time with us. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Professor Arya Gupta sir, for inspirational and motivational words. Sir. And I'm sure that the panelists will, during the next 5 days, will move in the directions given by you and help the technical university students in their goals.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, sir, for your kind presence, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
So, yes. Now 2 days. We all are joined on one platform for 5 days short-term training program. So let's begin with the first session, which is on nanotechnology as greener option for sustainable development by Dr. Nilima Gupta. Dr. Nilima Gupta, Senior Associate Professor in Department of Chemistry, University of Rajasthan, Jaipur, is presently holding position of Joint Director, Center of Converging Technologies, Course Coordinator, Computer Aided Drug Design, Design Innovation Center, Rajasthan University, and Coordinator, UGC, Center of Advanced Study in Chemistry. Her major area of research interest are synthetic organic chemistry, computational chemistry, molecular modeling, and computer-assisted drug design. She has worked as German Research Foundation-sponsored postdoc fellow at EMA University, Germany, and as visiting scientist at Philippus University, Germany, under Indo-German Cooperation Program. Dr. Gupta has supervised 15 PhD students and has more than 75 research publications in international journal of repute. She is author of reputed reference book series published by international publishers like King, Springer, etc. She had research projects sanctioned from major national funding agencies such as DST, UGC, CSIR, ICMR, including Indo-German Cooperation Program. She was awarded Fast Track Young Scientist Project by DST New Delhi. Several PhD students have worked in Germany under her research collaboration program. Dr. Gupta is life member of many academic professional societies and council member of CRSI, Bangalore, for last 2 terms, As a convener of the CRSI Rajasthan chapter, she is actively engaged in chemistry popularization program. She has organized many national and international conferences, workshops, and seminars. She has delivered more than 30 invited plenary and keynote lectures in international conference symposium in India and abroad. She is a resource person in refresher courses for teachers and workshops for research scholars in several universities. Dr. Gupta has received many awards and honors, including award for excellence in research among top researchers of the University of Rajasthan. She was conferred the ISCB Distinguished Women Scientists Award 2019 during Silver Jubilee celebration of Indian Society of Chemists and Biologists. Very recently, she has been elected as secretary of the prestigious Chemical Research Society of India, Bangalore, for next 3 years. Please, ma'am. Now we start for the first session.
Thank you, Anurika. First of all, I congratulate the organizers, Professor Dinesh Goyal, and the conveners of this short-term program, Dr. Sama Jain, Dr. Mohit, and the other chair and the conveners of this program for organizing this event, the 5-day long event, which is surely going to help the students and the faculty members. And again, to the chief guest, Dr. R.A. Gupta, Vice Chancellor, Rajasthan Technical University also. So he has inaugurated the program and motivated the faculty and the participants in a very good manner, and has talked about what are the responsibilities of the technical institute today. So this is true that we are giving in the technical institutes or in the regular academic universities the education to our students according to the curriculum. We want our students to study the particular curriculum and excel in that particular curriculum and secure some good marks for their placement. But the actual, the struggle starts after one joins his job. As mentioned by Professor Arya Gupta, that when someone joins some industry, he has to deal with the real life problem. The real life problems have to be dealt with the knowledge the student has acquired during his study tenure. So it's a very good thing that Professor Arya Gupta has mentioned that the faculty has to act as mentors for the student, so that they not only go through the curriculum to secure the marks in the examination, but they learn the technique, how to utilize the knowledge what they already have or what they can acquire as per the requisition of their job nature to solve the real-time problems whenever they face in their future. So with these words, today I'm going to talk about the nanotechnology because I am the joint director of the nanotechnology stream at the Center of Converging Technologies at the University of Rajasthan. So the promotion of nanotechnology also I consider one of my duties. Apart from this, as mentioned by the convener giving my introduction, I'm associated with the Chemical Research Society of India. So the chemistry is one branch which in many senses, in many ways, is connected with most of the branches of the engineering. So be it any branch of the, engineering or technology, the materials are involved. So if we say IT has nothing to do with chemistry, so that will not be correct, because when you are talking about IT, you need some gadgets, the mobile phones, smartphones, laptops, some hardware, some computer systems, some supercomputers. And what makes these devices work? The materials. So you need the smallest of the material, the smallest size of the material, giving you the input. So I will start with my presentation. So with the chemistry popularization program with Chemical Research Society of India, I am associated with. So now for the next 3 years, I'm the secretary of the society. So my duty to popularize the chemistry is now a little more. And the nanotechnology or the nanosciences or the nanomaterials is again one sister part, one major part of the chemistry today. So we are going to talk about the nanotechnology as greener option for the sustainable development with the theme of the program. So I hope I am properly audible to the participants.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So now I start with my proper lecture. So yeah. So we are going to talk about nanotechnology as greener option for sustainable development. And because now, right now, we are dealing with the COVID situation. So we have to deal with the COVID situation in a proper manner. How to deal with it, or how the nanotechnology is helping us in dealing with the present situation. That is going to be the key concern of my today's talk. Now, the theme of the workshop already is the environmental impacts on COVID-19 pandemic challenges and remedies in science and engineering. So when we talk about the challenges and remedies, specifically with science and engineering concept, so we can see if we go through the topics of the workshops or the conferences or the seminars these days during the last couple of years, I think 90% of the topics of the seminars, they have a few these words, sustainable development. So the sustainable development, this word has become so much popularized that it has become a very common word to our ears. So, but what this sustainable development actually is? So that sustainable development actually is, you know, the development, because we are living in an era, in a world where the development has gained a very fast pace. So you can see how much development in any sense, the agricultural production, our other issues. So the development in any area, even in the, you know, during recent days, there was a concern about, some disputes over the, borders of various countries, not only India, but some other countries also. So the warheads or the other things. So everywhere, the development is a continuous process. So development itself is a word that is a continuous process of making the things better for our living. So, but the sustainable development is one that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. So while we are working for the development today, we have to consider also how the future generations are going to face the situation or the resources. The most important thing is resources. So whether the resources will be available to the future generations for their development in their time. Okay. So now we are utilizing our resources, our natural resources, with such a fast pace that we cannot say in how many decades or in how many years some of the resources are going to be exhausted. One example I very commonly keep on giving, that being a chemistry teacher, I talk about periodic table. Periodic table is the listing of all the elements available with us, the natural elements as well as man-made artificial radioactive elements. So we have utilized so many materials for the development of the technological era, but technology, IT especially. So we are using, like today we are sitting at our home and we are attending this webinar, and we don't need to go to the university or the college, but we need the support of the gadgets, the laptops, the smartphones, and the other things. And in making of one smartphone, can we imagine how many elements are utilized? How many chemicals are utilized? And there are certain elements which are not available in abundance, but still we are utilizing them for the making of our smart devices. And then we are converting that material in unrecyclable mode. If the material is in recyclable mode, it can be utilized again and again, because we know the material is normally cannot be like created or cannot be like exhausted. But we are converting the material, taking it from the nature, utilizing it, and converting it into such a form. We know, I think we all know, how many smartphones or devices we throw away every year. Every year we are throwing away so many things, and they are not going for proper recycle mode. So the materials, the elements will be converted into a form in which they cannot be reused. So the future generations will be deprived of few things. So how to deal with this situation? So this situation can be dealt with the green technology. So this is a new word for last couple of decades, the green word with chemistry. So normally the green was botany, the green was trees, the green was nature, but now we are using this green technology or the green chemistry with the chemistry and with technology, the green technology. So why we are using this green word? The technology whose use is intended to mitigate or reverse the effect of human activity on the environment. So one important thing, if we are doing some activity, if we are manufacturing something, if we are utilizing some resources, and we are creating some situation, the things should be able to go back to the nature. So the recycling or the things going back to the nature in the original form is very important. And if we use any chemistry, any process, or any technology that reduces something which creates waste, so the reduction of waste or the availability of the material in a reusable mode can be considered as a part of green process or green technology. So how does the nanotechnology help us as a greener option? So the nanoscience and nanotechnology, it's a very common word now, is the working with matter on an ultra small scale. And nano means 1 nanometer. 1 nanometer we know is the 1 millionth of a millimeter. And if we want to give a real life example, what is the scale of the nanometer? The width of the human hair is around 80,000 nanometers. Okay. So the nanometer is some scale which is 80,000th times smaller than the thickness of our hair. The normal bacteria is of the size of 1,000 nanometer. The viruses are normally around 100 nanometer. The molecules are 5 nanometer and the atoms are 0.1 nanometer. So the nano word we can understand is very, very, very small, ultra small. So at the ultra small scale, what are the benefits? The benefits are, if we are using the nanoscale materials or nanotechnology, we are utilizing the material, in very, very small amount. And if we are using the material in very small amount, we are using it as a greener option. We are creating less waste. Okay. So the nanotechnology, if we go for of ideas to create devices and machines all the way down to the nanometer scale, which is billionth of a meter, about half the width of the human DNA molecule. Okay. So nanotechnology right now in today's time is an important field of applied science, which deals mainly with now design, synthesis, characterization, and application of materials on nanoscale. So if we are doing something with the word nanotechnology, so we are dealing with any one of these aspects. Now the nanotechnology itself alone is not standing somewhere to help us. The nanotechnology is a multidisciplinary as well as an interdisciplinary area of investigation and application. How does it mean? That the nanotechnology, with nanotechnology, one stream or one area within one stream, we have to consider many things all together with each other. And then we have to help the other branches of science also. When we say multidisciplinary, we know this nanotechnology, when we use the word technology, it becomes a part of the science and technology stream. We are creating some devices or we are creating some processes, but then we are utilizing some materials, so the chemistry is there. But we are using, if we are using something created with the help of nanotechnology or nanomaterials for the agricultural benefit, so then the agriculture also gets involved. If we are using something with nanotechnology or nanomaterials for health issues, the drugs or something, so then our botany and zoology and the medical science also gets involved. So the nanoscience and nanotechnology have the potential to open up new vistas in the field of research and development and various multiple disciplines. Nanomaterials and devices, they are very important as they play a major role in the field of pharmaceutical nanotechnology. So in today's, you know, world, what we are facing the most, the COVID-19 situation. So everyone is so much frightened, and not it's only Jaipur or Rajasthan or India, the USA and the Brazil and the Germany and the all developed and the developing and the underdeveloped countries. They all are facing the situation in a similar manner. So the nanomaterials and devices, they can be helpful in pharmaceutical things. Because the most important, you know, the question, when we meet each other, when we are over the telephone calls, what is, you know, hurting us the most? We are not able to meet each other. Our lifestyle has changed. We are not able to meet our friends. We are not able to go outside to have dinners together, the parties. Why? Because of the COVID situation. And what is the question? Oh, when will the vaccine be there? We are waiting for the vaccine. We are waiting for the vaccine, not only waiting for the vaccine, but for the results from the vaccine. So will there be in the near future a situation that as the case with other cases, now we know we have the vaccine for the flu, we have the vaccine for the typhoid or pneumonia or so many things. And once we get vaccinated, the small kid when, you know, is added up to our family, and the first thing starts is the vaccination. So BCG and polio and so many other diseases. So the vaccination is something which gives us the confidence to live a healthy life. We can live a healthy life by adopting some healthy practices, but our environment is something which we have, the physical environment, the nature, pollution, so many things, and also the other people with whom we are living. And we know because why the situation became pandemic. Because the disease is so easy, so it's getting spreading from one to other very quickly. So, you know, our life today on the earth, here we can see on the screen the four most important issues. I think last year, when I used this same slide, the environment was on the left side and the health was on the right side. Because last year, if I use the same slide, the environment was the most important issue to be dealt with today to have a better life. But in few months, the situation changed. The health has come on the first place, leaving the environment at the second place. Then the two other important things are energy and the food. So to live a healthy life, we need a good environment, pollution-free environment. And then, as Professor Arya Gupta also mentioned, the energy. We use to show our gratitude towards sun and the people tree. Okay, so that signifies the people tree here signifies the environment aspect here, what is being shown on the slide, that environment is so important to us, and our old generations, they used to show their gratitude towards the things around us which used to give us healthy life. Then the sun, the energy, we know a lot of research is going on the energy storage devices, you know, the hydrogen to be used as new energy source. We need to have some device which can store hydrogen and release it as and when required. So the nano materials or the research in the nanotechnology area is one important aspect which is being used to deal with the energy aspect. Then the food. Food is something which we know we all will be needing in future also. So the quality of food, the quantity of food, the two important issues. How to increase the quantity of food material with not compromising with the quality of food. So whenever nowadays we are buying our food material, we are concerned about the quality also. So how to maintain the quality, how to improve the quality, how to improve the, you know, food value of the material, food material, the your healthy these things. So we need to have better or quality food production, agricultural production, not only the quantity but quality also. So when we are talking about the nano scale things, the COVID-2019 is already a nano scale thing. Most of the members of the member viruses of this family Corona viridae are enveloped 80 to 220 nanometer in size. They are pleomorphic and often spherical. So Corona viridae is a family which has several virus classes with different shapes. The coronaviruses have a member of the same family have spherical shape. And specifically the coronaviruses, they are spherical. What is a virus? It is a genetic material. It is RNA protein, which is enveloped in a layer. When we say we should wash our hands more frequently with soap, why do we say that the lipid layer around the genetic material, when we wash our hands frequently with soap, it gets broken away. When it breaks away, the genetic material dies. Okay. So now the genetic material enveloped in a lipid envelope or a layer is a virus. So now the average size of the coronavirus is around 120 nanometer. This 120 nanometer has some 80 to 85 nanometer as the core genetic material, and the envelope around it has the spike. So the coronavirus, we know, we are seeing the animated or the cartoonized pictures of the coronavirus also so often. So the spikes are there, which are 20 nanometer long. So the coronavirus itself is of nano size. So the problem has to be dealt with the nanotechnology. So we have to deal with coronavirus considering its ultra small size. So the nanotechnology has gained importance during, I think, last 3 or 4 decades. It has gained more popularity, and the R&D, the research being done in this area, has increased tremendously. But the initially, if we go back to the history, so it was 1960s, the idea and concept behind nanoscience and nanotechnology started with the talk entitled There is Plenty of Room at the Bottom by physicist Richard Feynman. At American Physical Society meeting at California Institute of Technology, he has given a talk talking about ultra small things, that whatever space is left with us, very small space, that is also important. And the materials of that small size give you plenty of opportunities to work with. Special features of nanotechnology, as we can see on the slide, is the vast increase surface area to volume ratio. So if we are talking about the nanomaterial, the particle size is of nano size, so the surface area increases because you are breaking away the material into very fine particles, and each fine particle has its own surface area. And the use of nanomaterials with the increased surface area, how does it help us? We can see some examples: the use of nanocatalysis, graphene, buckyballs, nanotubes, nanosynthesis, nanomedicine, nanobiotechnology. These are certain areas where the things are being used. The notable developments in the area during very recent past are the drug delivery. In drug delivery, the nano encapsulated things are being used. In agriculture, the crop protection and livestock productivity, safe purification techniques for water treatment, early detection of disease, solar power for energy storage. So these are some key areas where the major research in nanotechnology is being done today. So these are some of the areas which utilize nanotechnology in a very, very, measurable quantity. So again, coming back to the same slide, the health is most important today, energy, food, and environment. We can see in the previous slide what I have shown, the notable latest advancement. Okay, so the latest advancements of the research in nanotechnology, they address all 4 important aspects of our life today. Then to some more details, the nanotechnology has become a revolutionary technology, having potential to open up new vistas in the field of research and development. So if you want to go into more details, the healthcare, medicine, electronics, textiles, agriculture, construction, water treatment, food processing, cosmetics. So these are some areas where the nanotechnology or nanomaterials or nanoprocesses are being used. Much of these applications are very much pertinent for a developing country like India. In this context, the government has been playing a pioneering role in fostering and promoting nanotechnology R&D in India since early 2000. So here in next 2 slides, I want to mention and bring to the notice of the participants what Indian government is doing to promote the research in the area of nanotechnology. So the Indian government has identified it 2 decades back, and in early 2000, Nano Mission was launched. Nano Mission was launched by the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, to foster, promote, and develop all aspects of nanoscience and nanotechnology. So the Nano Mission Council was framed with the chairmanship of Professor C.N.R. Rao. So under this flagship program, the research and development, the institutional, the infrastructure, the human resource, there are certain aspects which the government is funding. So if someone wants to get more information about what government is doing or how the government is helping the institutions or the individuals for doing research in the areas of nanotechnology, they can go to the website of the Department of Science and Technology and can look for the Nano Mission pages. since last two decades, some of the notable projects on nanotechnology in India have been undertaken, and here is a list of some of them. Like you can see, nanocrystalline diamond films, ceramic powders, you know, wear resistance, durability. Then there are carbon nanotubes for various things, rubber nanocomposites, nanoparticles for chemotherapy drug carriers. So as I had told you that the targeted therapy, the targeted drug therapy has become one important thing that we are having, suppose in cancer, we are having some malignant cells and we want only those cells to be targeted by the medicine. So the things are encapsulated with the nanomaterials and they go inside our body and only they are triggered in the when they enter in the malignant cells only and the drug is released. So these are certain very advanced things which are using the nanotechnology and nanomaterials. Carbon nanotubes, as we know, they exhibit extraordinary strength and they have unique electrical properties. They are efficient conductors of heat. They have novel properties that make them potentially useful for many applications in electronics, optics, and other fields, in architectural fields also. For the students of the civil engineering or the architecture, so because they need materials with extraordinary strength sometimes. So the reinforced things, the rubber, carbon nanotube reinforced rubber materials, so they have become available. So a lot of research is going on in the area of nanotechnology related things. Now, coming to the last part of my today's talk, I would like to apprise the participants with the quantum of research which is being held today. Just, you know, right one day back, yesterday. So what research is being done in the areas of nanotechnology and how this is important. So we can see here, you know, the web of science. Okay. The web of science is one such platform where you come to know about the research publications in the area of science and technology. So you can see in 2018, approximately 166,000 articles were indexed. The published articles may be even more, the number may be even more. But the indexed articles, that means those research articles which were published and then were indexed in these databases, the number was approximately 166,000. That was 10% of the total research publication. Okay, so the 10% of the research publications dealing with nanotechnology, that gives it a great, quite significant number among the different branches of science, chemistry, materials, physics, and respectively the large share of indexed nano articles. Okay, then which countries are contributing more research in the areas of nanotechnology? We can see here China, United States, and then India. They are the three leading countries in publication of nano articles. You can go to the, you know, website NanoStats. Okay, so this NanoStats you can visit to find out the exact statistics about the nanotechnology research articles. I would like to show you one video, if it is possible to play here, which will tell you how the nanotechnology research in India has advanced during last two decades. So here we can see you in the table given here, 2015, 16, 17, 18, 19, and 2020 May. Until 2020 May, the initial only 4 months, 36,000 articles by China, 10,000 by USA, and 7,000 articles by India has already published. Okay, so the quantum of research with nanotechnology related things is increasing. I would like to play this very small thing, if it is possible. Yes, we can see here, look at this graph, the USA, Japan, Germany. Where is India? India is here. Okay, so 2003, India is going up here. Italy, India is, you know, here, 2006, it has surpassed Italy, Russia, 2007, It has surpassed UK 2009. How fast? You can see the number of research publications made by India in the area of nanotechnology here. Fast moving up. In 2014 itself, the India has come on the third place in the world. And the number of publication is now increasing. The China decreasing. We can see. Okay. So how the India has come up from bottom to the third place in the research being done in the area of nanotechnology. So coming further, how nanotechnology is being used in battle against coronavirus. So we can see.
Yes.
Okay. So we can see here the nanotechnology in battle against coronavirus, how it is helping us. The novel coronavirus disease was, first reported in Wuhan, China on December 31st itself. The name of the disease given COVID-19 by World Health Organization. And if we compare the same with other coronaviruses disease like, SARS and MERS, the fatality rate of COVID-19 is substantially lower. As we have seen during last few months, the recovery rate is quite high, which has given us a lot of confidence that if someone gets the corona disease, unless or until he has some other health issues, serious health issues related to heart or lungs or some diabetes or something, it is not very dreadful. The patient gets cured, in few days only. But the major problem is it is more transmissible. So the fast pace with which it gets spreaded from one person to not another, from one person to maybe 10 or 100, and then from 100 to 1,000. It has spread during the last 4 or 5 months to over 213 countries, infected more than, we can see here how many people claim over 642,000 lives. So this is the data up to July 25th, 2 days back. You can see at Worldometer. Okay. So as one of the game changers of the past decade, the nanotechnology holds great promise in offering innovative solutions to a wide range of problems regarding, if we talk about COVID-19, prevention, diagnosis, and treatment. So these are three important aspects we know. These days, the lockdown was there. We all were staying at our home. We wanted to prevent the spread of the disease. But in any case, if someone gets infected, the diagnosis is important. We know RT-PCR tests and the other antibody tests, so many kits have come in the market. Some kits imported from China had been questions also. So the diagnosis is again very important. How to get fast results at a cheaper rate? And the nanotechnology is helping us in that also. And then for the treatment. So the treatment of COVID-19, we are waiting for the vaccine. We can see in next couple of slides how nanotechnology is going to help us. So here we can see technology against COVID-19, prevention, diagnosis, and treatment. So here is, you can see a list of some research publications. The research publications made during recent time. So we, start from here. The first you can see, October 10, 2019, the bottom line. Bottom line, the first publication came, a nanotechnology research collaboration between Harvard University and Moderna. Okay, so that was something. Then in December, it was announced by WHO. In January 28, there was an article. You all interested people, you can go to the NanoStat website and you can get the links for all these listings. So this link will take you to the publication which appeared on January 28 and what it said. what was the detailed content. So you all can go to any of these links. And February 14, nanotechnology enabled N95 mask. February 25, nanotechnology startup for test, coronavirus test. Okay. So then you can see Novavax deploys nanoparticle vaccine technology. So all this research, it went on, you know, coming up January, February, March. And then when we go to June, the number of publications increased. Okay. So these all research outputs related with the COVID thing using the nanotechnology. And the next one we can see here, July 26th. July 26th means yesterday only. So yesterday this article has come up, lipid-based nanoparticle emulsion vaccine neutralizes COVID-19 in mice. So this article has appeared yesterday only. July 24th, Novavax nanoparticle vaccine received fund, $384 million fund. So all this nanoparticle-based vaccine, okay? So all these research articles which are appearing continuously from June till July till yesterday, they give you an idea how nanotechnology is being used to help in dealing with the COVID-19 situation. So there are some organizations throughout the world which are deploying nanotechnology to detect and tackle the coronavirus. So again, this all information is available at the NanoState website. I have taken up some of the examples here to give you an idea. Moderna Inc. is a biotechnology company focusing on the drug discovery and drug development. So now it is, you know, using some nanoparticle encapsulated messenger RNA vaccine against COVID-19 so that it can stabilize the formation of spikes of the COVID coronavirus protein. Okay, so Novavax and Nanovirisite, so these all companies, they are using nanotechnology to deal with the COVID-19 problem. Here you can see CanSino Biologics, Sona Nanotech. So these all companies, these all projects are using nanotechnology to deal with the COVID-19 problem in all three ways: prevention, diagnosis, and treatment. Again, you can see, some very new companies, Oxford Nanopore. We know the vaccine has already being produced, and the trials have 2 days back started in India also. So UOVAX, in 2018, the company was founded only 2 years back, and it is doing some good research in nanotechnology, using nanotechnology for dealing with the challenges of the drug discovery time. So there are some other products also, nanotechnology-based products. We can see here, 20-year-old carbon nanotube sensor, which was reported 20 years back. So nanotube, we can see here, there is a, carbon nanotube, and inside might be very perfect to encapsulate the coronavirus. So sensor, the basis of today's COVID-19 detector. So here, there are some other products using the nanotechnology or the nanomaterials, anti-coronavirus nanoparticle-based coatings for healthcare and public settings. So some of the researchers are working on the nanomaterial coatings to make them repellent for the coronavirus. We know today when we get online supplies of groceries or something to our houses, or we bring something to our house, we are afraid of how to use them. We keep on washing them with soap or some other spray or so many things. So if we make the surface coronavirus repellent, if the coronavirus is not able to stick to the surface, so that can be one area. We are reading in the newspapers or in the messages that how long the virus can stick to the plastics or paper or glass or the metallic surface. So we are taking so many precautions accordingly. Then there is the security marker for tracing and verifying quality of the face mask. We are buying the face mask, we are preparing it at home, we are purchasing and using it, but whether the quality of mask is good enough to protect you against the coronavirus. So there are so many researches going on. Self-sterilizing, nano-coating, and no more coronavirus infected surfaces. So a lot of research is being done in the area of things to deal with COVID-19 situation using nanotechnology and nanomaterials. So, only some 15 days back, this research article was published in ACS Nano, so which says that face masks combined with one layer of tightly woven cotton sheet and two layers of polyester spandex chiffon can effectively filter out aerosol particles ranging from 10 nanometer to 6 micrometer in diameter. So if some of you have come around some of the advertisements of the mask, face mask made up with khadi or the silk material. So chiffon, when we say it is the fine, thread, the silk and the chiffon, they have very fine thread. So the pore size is very small. So different researches are going on how the material can be combined together to deal with the efficacy of the mask. So this article was published only 12 or 13 days back in the journal American Chemical Society, ACS Nano. So we can see, concluding my today's presentation, at a prevention stage, nanofiber based facial respirators. So these are some of the important researches which were reported only during the recent times to deal with the COVID-19. So some important one of them are nanofiber based facial respirators along with nanotechnology enabled high effective antimicrobial and antiviral disinfectant. Then extensive research is underway to develop a vaccine for COVID-19 based on different nanomaterials. Again, the nanomaterials are an important component of the research being done in the area of vaccine. In diagnostics, when we talk about diagnostic things, nanotechnology has shown considerable promise in designing sensors for developing quick response COVID-19 tests. At the treatment phase, nanomedicines have been at the center of many researchers' attention, some of which are currently being studied in clinical trials. So we have seen during the last week only, some of the medicines have entered the second phase trial or the first phase trial. So we hope that with the help of these nanotechnology assisted things, we will be able to deal with the COVID-19 pandemic situation in very near future. So here I would like to end my talk with this last slide to apprise the participants and the faculty about the Center of Converging Technologies at the University of Rajasthan, where we have integrated BTech MTech program in converging technologies. So in today's world, the converging technology has become very important. And the converging technology initially was NBIC, N nanotechnology, assisted with B biotechnology, I information technology, and C is cognitive science, because the human health or the human nature or the human mental framework is very important. With your mental framework only, you are able to apply the information technology, and the biotechnology and the nanotechnology, these four together make NBIC stream. During last couple of years, it was observed this NBIC stream is missing something. What was missing? The innovation, the business, the commercialization. So whatever innovation is to be done with the use of these four streams together has to make commercialize. And to make it commercialize, how to start your own company, how to make you think. So the student should know about the business tactics also. So these are some aspects which, if studied together, they make NBIC plus stream. So that is something which is becoming very popular in some of the leading universities of the world. And we are having one such course in our Jaipur in the Rajasthan University also. So how nanotechnology can work by joining hands with other branches of science and technology to deal with, you know, the other problems which I have not covered much in today's talk, the environment, the energy, and the other food and agriculture problems because of the paucity of time. Today, because of the title of the, you know, your workshop and in the present day's COVID-19 situation, I have mostly talked about the helping hand of nanotechnology to deal with COVID-19 situation. So thanks for the kind attention of the audience. And with again, thanks to the organizers, Dr. Sama Jain and Dr. Mohit, for inviting me to give this talk in this workshop.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you very much, ma'am, for your precious time and valuable information shared with all of us. And now I'm just sharing two questions I have. Ma'am, I'm audible to you?
Yeah.
Okay. So, ma'am, the first question is nanotechnology is one of cause of pollution? In which domain nanotechnology will be most significant as future aspect?
You know, okay.
Shall I repeat the question, ma'am?
Okay, so I can see the questions myself also.
Yeah,
is nanotechnology is one of the cause of pollution.
Yeah.
You know, Ajay Yadav has asked this question. So, it is not nanotechnology the cause of pollution. You know, when we were small kids studying in schools a couple of decades back, we used to have some Hindi or English literature paper and or some science. So we were required to write an essay. And one favorite topic was whether the science or the technology is our master, or our slave. So the technology or whatever development is being done with the help of science, we are using it for our benefit. So it is how we use it. If we are using it in a proper manner, we are making the science and technology our slave and using it in our benefit. But if we are not utilizing the things in a proper manner, we are releasing, you know, those slaves in open field to act, to become and act as masters over us. So same way, the nanotechnology is very important because, you know, as I told you, the quantity of material is very important nowadays. We are utilizing the material with such a fast pace. Believe me, you know, the mobile phone, what we buy for us any time of the year, we think at that time that, okay, this has got the most advanced features and will be able to address our needs during next 3-4 years. So we are spending our money and our time to identify, you know, the latest mobile phone. But only 6 months down the lane, we feel, oh, my mobile phone doesn't have this feature. It doesn't have good camera. It is not able to give me, you know, good streaming. And a new mobile phone has come up in the market. And our, you know, pocket has become affordable, like we can afford another new mobile phone. So it is not essentially that our old smartphone becomes useless. Then only we buy the new phone. Okay, so what we are doing, we are purchasing something. When we are purchasing something, the consumer market is there. So the factories are manufacturing it. When the factories are manufacturing it, they are utilizing the resources, the new materials. Every 6 months, a new, you know, new feature is there with the smartphone. How many smartphones we are discarding? You cannot imagine. even, you know, only in, I had some data last time in UK or something, some, you know, lakhs of mobile phones are discarded. Okay, every month. So, where does this material going? Most of the time, it is becoming waste. Because your handset in your hand has got so many elements. You cannot imagine the number of elements used to make this one smart gadget. So it has got so many elements, but the quantity is so small, it is not recoverable. Most of the things, they are going waste. Kitne to hamare ghar mein almiras ke andar hi hum aise hi patak ke dal dete hain, unko recycle hone ke liye bhejte bhi nahi hain. Pade honge sabke almiras mein, drawers mein, old mobile phones, jo kaam nahi aa rahe honge, useless ho gaye honge, but still they are lying. So we are wasting our resources. We have to think about it. In a similar manner, when we talk about nanotechnology, nanotechnology is there to help us with the quantity. In small quantity, we can perform larger function. So it is very useful because the resources are limited to be able to use small quantity. But one has, if you are using nanomaterial, you have to use it in a proper manner. You to take precaution that you do not release the things in the environment. If you are releasing the things in the environment, then only the pollution is there, na? Okay. So we have some factories. So in those factories, you know, some polluting gases or some materials are made, and it is released in the environment through chimneys. So it is not a solution that stopped that factory. The solution should be the new research to be done, how we can capture the byproducts and can utilize in a proper manner where they can be used. So if there is some byproduct, if it is released in the environment and it becomes hazardous to our lives, it has to be first collected in a proper manner, and then we have to find a way to utilize it for another purpose. So that is something. So it is not the nanotechnology, it is the way if we are trying to utilize it.
Sure, thank you, ma'am.
And the second question was, what is the future scope of green technology and its role in improving nature in emerging needs of adverse environment stuff? So I think in so many slides shown today in during my lecture, I have already shown the green technology, the definition was create less waste, atom economy. If you don't create waste, okay, so the green technology is helping you. So there is a lot and lot of scope. There is a lot of scope where you can utilize green technology, create less waste, and use such conditions where you do not have hazardous byproducts.
Thank you, ma'am. We have still more questions, but due to lack of time, I request all participants to send your question through mail, and we will try to respond for all of your questions. And now we have to again join for next session at 1 p.m. So for this time, we are leaving this session. Thank you very much, ma'am, for sharing valuable inputs with all of our participants. Thank you, ma'am, for giving your precious time. We have taken extended time from the scheduled time. Thank you very much.
Welcome. Welcome all.